business. Opportunities are like buses. There is always one coming. Moral lesson for you here is to never desist it from trying again, because who knows, you could still get the client that you missed yesterday. Hello, and welcome to this week's edition of The Business Show. Before we start, let's run through the events that made the business week locally and internationally. Kampala Innovation Week 2021 officially opens in Uganda. MTN Uganda to list on Uganda's securities exchange. Small-scale players want tax incentives to recover from COVID-19. France warns that agreements with the UK are at risk. And South Korea becomes the first major Asian economy to raise interest rates.
Stakeholders, all right, like FSDU, like Minister of Finance, like private sector foundation, Uganda, all right, all these other ones need to come together to ensure that they are working for the good of this fintechs.
The problem has never been capital in this business.
Thank you for joining us. Now, financial innovation has played an integral role in the formation and transformation of the global financial sector. A variety of fintech firms are emerging globally and locally here in Uganda too. These firms are offering new products and services underpinned by new technologies. Tonight on Views from the Top, we'll look at the future of fintech in Uganda and how exactly it could spur financial sector growth.
My name is Dan Edoma. I work predominantly in the financial technology industry, focusing more on advising institutions on the setup and scaling of various fintech products in the region and beyond. Financial technology industry started about a decade or so ago, and it's a subset within financial services, and it predominantly focuses on usage of technology to improve the delivery of financial services. And an example of a typical financial technology product is the mobile money. How mobile money has, you know, improved the transfer of money from one end to another. Predominantly started as a peer-to-peer transfers, but then over the years that has sort of, you know, broadened to where we've seen business to consumer payments as well as government to people or to the population payments. So that is more of the nutshell, the introduction of what fintech is and what it does. Fintech alone doesn't necessarily have to focus on the transfer of money, but it can also be ways of non-money transfers. For example, we've seen cases where people, fintechs that focus on provisional vouchers. So instead of an institution giving you cash, they can give you a voucher, which could be, say for example, a seed voucher, where you're able to go to a particular shop and redeem the seeds through the voucher. That could be one. It could be school fees voucher, where, you know, a parent, instead of paying cash, can be able to get the voucher and then the kid goes to school and be able to redeem. Even I've seen cases where people are able to send pocket money through vouchers, where kids are able to go to the respective canteens at their institutions of learning and redeem the vouchers in forms of groceries. But looking at Uganda, I think the advancement of financial inclusion has been enormous. As I mentioned earlier on, it started as mobile money, but that has broadened, all right? And there's more and more solutions coming up to, you know, to improve on what was already established, all right? So I see so much happening and so much yet to come. Fintech is coming to improve and make your payment seamless, all right? Is it seamless? That's one. Two, is it cost effective? Because you're going to be, you know, the ultimate cost bearer, all right? So you're going to introduce the aspect of cost. And then thirdly is, are you able to fulfill what you wanted to achieve? What do I mean? Say, for example, if you wanted to do payment from point A to point B, does that solution offer you that? Okay, we've seen cases where it has to do with even with exchange. Can it give you a favorable forex, all right? So those are aspects to look into when you're looking at options that are in the market. Fintech has been super effective in a couple of ways. One is it has advanced financial inclusion. When you look historically, the financial services, all right, we started with the banks, all right, then microfinance institutions came, all right, but the way, the rate at which they were reaching out to individuals in the communities is not as high as what financial technology has done over the years. All right, when you look at Uganda's population vis-a-vis the bankable population vis-a-vis the banked the actual banked numbers, you find that the number that's banked is very small. All right, but what financial technology has done over the years is, one, it has reached out to the unbanked population effectively. Two is it has given people a financial identity, all right, that a person has. You can go through your, for example, your statement on your mobile money, all right, and that gives a financial identity. You'll be able to see your inflows, all right, vis-a-vis your outflows. Okay, that's one. And then secondly is that people that are in far areas that are unreachable by the banks can be able to access financial services with ease, all right? For example, MTN and the other telecom companies or mobile money service providers now have what they call money lending issues. I mean, services that are on phone. You just go on your phone, you're able to request for the amount that you need. Within a period of time, it's approved and you're able to get the money on your phone. Something that used to not be the case. You need to go to the bank and line up. All right, so it has reduced the cost in terms of time, but also in terms of how much you'll spend the other resources to go to a bank. Okay, so that's one. Two is it has made it easier for people to approach these services. And then lastly is you're able to easily and effectively send money in Uganda anywhere, anytime. In the process of registering for some of the services, you have to provide information. The information could be your first, middle, and last name. It could be your date of birth. It could be your phone number. It could be your area of residence and all that. Information that are privy, they are super personal, all right? But however, this information is not easily shared to third parties, all right? They are owned by institutions that have acquired them. All right, we haven't had cases where they are sharing this information with other parties that are not partial to the intended use. All right, that's one. And then secondly is I think the government is also working hard to ensure that there is data protection, that we're not just going to draw information from one place and take it to the use in another area. Okay, and then lastly is the fact that most of these companies have privacy protection. All right, whereby when you provide your information, it's easily protected within the company laws. All right, that's why you see internationally, when you register an app or download an app with either on Android or iOS, all right, you have to go through their data protection manual or agreement. Read it. If you agree to it, then you're able to share it, all right, and download it. But if not, you have the right not to. So the same way with the services, you can choose to sign or not sign, but know very well that your data is safe with these organizations. And just like any other institutions, if they don't have the right protections in place, it can be easily hacked and your information will be shared with other parties. So what the central bank did was to introduce a sandbox, right? Which makes it easier for people who are trying to tap into this industry. All right, first of all, you have access to the regulator, okay, easily, that's one. Secondly is, you are able to tap into the other innovations. You don't need to reinvent the wheel. This is already established, so you just continue from there. So I think what the government, through the central bank, is trying to do is, one, increase creativity and innovation in this space, but secondly is ensure that it's done in an open manner, all right? So you're able to know what your other person is doing and see if you can be able to work together to achieve the common goal. A couple of things need to be done. One is stakeholders, all right, like FSDU, like Ministry of Finance, like private sector foundation, Uganda, all right, all these other ones need to come together to ensure that they are working for the good of these fintechs. Because what happens in Uganda is that there's a gap, all right, and this gap can only be filled through collaborative approach where all these entities come together to support these young entrepreneurs, all right? So entrepreneurs feel the support is limited. And the limit is simple because there's a bit of, you find what FSD is doing is alone, what Ministry of Finance is doing alone, what Bank of Uganda is doing alone, all right? But if all these entities were able to come together and organize town halls, all right, which could be quarterly, where they bring all fintechs or all innovative solutions to come together. One, brainstorm ideas. Two is see what are some of the prevailing situations in their industry and then work together for their good to ensure that those issues are addressed. FITSPA is doing a lot, all right, and was introduced to ensure that that gap is reduced, to lobby for the fintechs, all right, to the government and the other stakeholders. And they have been doing that over the years and they continue to do it. But it's more of also these entities, the governments, government agencies to come together and embrace what these locals are doing.
Over the past 2 years, the average annual growth rate for fintech in Uganda has been 35%. The question, however, remains how effectively this is going to be regulated. You're watching The Business Show. Time now for a quick break.